If you're watching online, it's great to have you with us. We just pray that you will receive that blessing, that anointing too, in your homes, that you will be a fragrance and aroma of Christ wherever you are. Well, I want to share with you this morning about restoration. I don't know about you, but I cannot get away from this theme. And the verse, of course, that we know for this year from 1 Peter, the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ after you've suffered a little while, we don't like that bit, do we? Will himself restore you and make you strong, firm and steadfast. He's going to build us up, friends. To him be power forever and ever. Amen. That's 1 Peter. And I want to share with you from Ephesians this morning about how we can be restored. I think virtually every message in 2024 has been about restoration. And friends, I just want to encourage you, don't let a single area of your life remain unrestored. Give your life over, fully surrendered to the one who is the great restorer, to the one who can do better than any art restorer, as well as they do. But he can restore lives, he can restore hearts, he can restore marriages, he can restore relationships, finances, he can restore situations and circumstances, he can restore the past. What he wants to do is to restore you to your original purpose that was his original intention in his heart before you were even a twinkle in your mum's eye. So, Father, we pray this morning as we seek to be restored more and more that your precious Holy Spirit would come and do a work in us that we can't do ourselves, but we give ourselves up to you. In Jesus' name, amen. We know that Paul, probably one of Paul's favorite places to be, was Ephesus. We've heard a lot about this over the last few months, even over the last few years. And we ourselves here at Revival Fires are so similar to the church at Ephesus, the apostolic center that the Apostle Paul set up. And why I think this was one of his favorite places is because as we read through the book, we hear the book of Ephesians, we hear his heart poured out for the people there. His prayers poured out for the people there. The Apostle Paul wrote the book of Ephesus, probably from a place of imprisonment to a church that he just loved. You've heard us speak about Acts chapter 19, where he went to Ephesus as part of his missionary journeys, and he found a group of 12 people there, and he said to them, have you received the Holy Spirit? I love it. Paul just gets right in there. Have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? And there they are, just shaking their heads. We didn't know about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Baptism, yeah, we've all been baptized with water because we knew about John's message, John the Baptist's message. So he goes straight in, and that chapter in Acts talks about an amazing revolution that happened in that city. It was a pagan area. There was lots of idol worship, occult worship. And yet the Holy Spirit broke in. Friends, this is like our place. This is like Dudley. This is a place where it's not overflowing with Christians, where there may be some people that still need to receive the baptism in the Holy Spirit. But just what happened there, I'm praying that happens here, not just in our four walls, but in the area, in the town, in the city, in the area around us. The Holy Spirit broke in. He stayed there for 2 years teaching. He poured his life life out into the church, into the city of Ephesus. And not only did he teach in the synagogues and the centers, but it says he went from home to home. And at the end of that, in Acts, it says, I didn't hold back from giving you the whole counsel of God. Paul loved the church in Ephesus. And in fact, even John, when he wrote in the book of Revelation, he said of the church of Ephesus, because he knew they had a first love, just like Paul had a love for them, they had a first love for God. He said, come back to your first love. This is the church in Ephesus I'm talking to you about. All this teaching, all these miracles, things going on in the high street. They had fire, they were burning their occult practices, their occult artifacts, and there was extraordinary miracles. The Spirit of God, the power of God broke in, and Paul loved this church, and he wrote this wonderful book of Ephesians. I just love the Pauline letters, but especially this book of Ephesians. And many of the speakers who've been in over all of us here in the team, but those who've been at conferences have been saying, this is a time for the book of Joshua and for the book of Ephesians. So if wherever you are in your Bible readings, add to it the book of Joshua and the book of Ephesians. And I want to look at the verses starting at verse 15. And I'm going to read this verse to you, and then I'm going to talk about the restoration of prayer. I'm going to talk about different aspects of restoration, but let's read from verse 15. For this reason, says Paul, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all God's people, I've not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he's called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is the same as the mighty strength which he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms. Friends, when we were singing those words this morning, worthy is the Lamb seated on the throne, I saw King Jesus seated on the throne there at the right hand of God. And I want to remind you, we are seated there with him in heavenly places because of the work that Christ has done for us on the cross. And because of this, I want us to recognize the position that he has given to us. Some of us may have slid a little. Some of us may have slid a lot. Some of us may feel, I need a total restoration, Sharon. This is the morning for you to realize that God is restoring. He is realigning. He is rearranging. He is breathing fresh life upon you. First of all, in these verses that I've read, Paul talks about a restoration of prayer. Paul describes his prayer. Now, I don't know about you, I need all the help I can get in prayer. These last few weeks, I've been saying to the Lord, now, how can I see my prayer life restored? So you'll think this is funny. So I try and get to all the prayer that I can hear. So the 10 o'clock prayer where we pray together. It's great to pray together. People encourage you. So when I'm with another believer, I'm getting into the habit or reminding myself of the habit. What can I pray for you? And they'll say, and what can I pray for you? In our lives together, we do daily readings almost every day, and we pray together. I find these last few months that has been so much stronger for us as a couple than at any other time of our life, and I just bless God for that. Prayer is not an easy thing for me. I don't know if I'm alone here, but I've in my personal prayer life, I've been saying, Lord, just help me. So I'm a list person, which makes some people laugh, I know, and makes some people think, oh, good, so am I. So I've been thinking, okay, on a Monday, I could pray for this. For mission, because M is Monday for mission. And on a Tuesday, I already got stuck. I'm thinking, I can't believe this. So, you know, Tuesday, okay, I can pray for Trevor on Tuesday. I pray for you more than once a week, Trev. But anyway, Tuesday can be my pray for Trevor. Wednesday, what can we pray for on a Wednesday then? Women. Okay, women on a Wednesday. Thursday, any ideas? No. Friday? Well, any freedom. Okay, so you could go through the week. You could do this. I've got a list in the back of my journal. So I read and journal every day. I've got a list in the back of my journal of all the people that I want to pray for, of all the places that I want to pray for, of the leaders in the churches that we go and visit that have said, pray for us. And I'm thinking, Lord, I want to remember to pray for them. A few weeks ago, I was so overburdened with how can I remember to pray? How, you know, what good can my prayers do? And the Lord reminded me of the great high priestly prayer in John 17, where Jesus says, I don't pray for the world. I'm thinking, oh, what a relief. I don't pray for the world. I pray for those whom you have given to me. And I'm thinking, Lord, all I've got to do is align with you to pray for those that you've given me. And he said, I've not lost one of them except for Judas, who was the son of perdition. I'm thinking, Lord, I just want to align with you in my prayer times. Lord, I'm not talking about, can I pray for hours? Lord, if I can just pray for a few minutes, that communion with you, those few words with you, whether it's half an hour, whether it's an hour, whether I'm speaking in tongues and practicing that for 10 minutes every day, whatever your prayer life is like, whatever my prayer life is like, I want to see a restoration of prayer. I want to see a restoration of prayer in me, in us, in our families. You know, we can just pray for each other. Do you remember Jesus said to one of the somebody in the Gospels, he said, it's not about how long you pray for. It's not about vain repetition. Just for goodness sake, get to the point and pray. You know, when we talk to each other, we don't need to go around the houses. God knows already. But let me tell you, let me help you with some prayer. And let me describe how Paul prays. First of all, it says, I pray, I've not stopped giving thanks for you. Look at that. I've not stopped giving thanks for you. And the word thanks there, it's eucharisteo in the Greek, and that's like the word Eucharist. So that reminds us of the bread and wine, because in Anglican churches they call that the Eucharist. It's to do with saying words around that gift that God has given to us. And when I looked this up, you know, that word is used a few times in the New Testament, always in connection with the miraculous. I'm thinking, giving thanks is connected to the miraculous. So Paul gives thanks for Ephesus, and there's an expectation attached to that thanksgiving of the miraculous. So this word was used when Jesus had a few loaves and fish and said, Father, I thank you. Eucharisteo. I thank you. What was about to happen? There was just an increase, a multiplication. And then when he stood at Lazarus's tomb there in Luke 11, it says he was weeping because his friend had died. Nobody knew why he hadn't intervened. But there he stood at the tomb and he prayed for 3 days. No, he didn't. He prayed a really short prayer and he said, Father, I thank you. And I'm praying this prayer so that others will know that I'm praying. But I know that you've done it already. He used this word, giving thanks, Eucharisteo. And what happened? Lazarus was raised from the dead by this prayer of thanksgiving. Friends, when we give thanks, even like grace before a meal, expect the miraculous. You might not need your shepherd's pie to feed 5,000, but you need a miracle. Use your times before a meal to pray, to give thanks to God. Then what does he say? I give thanks to you, remembering you in my prayers. Oh, on Friday night at the Gather the Girls, somebody prayed for me and they said, God, give her clarity in her memory. I'm thinking, I'll take that. I'll take that with people's names, with events, with times. With remembering to pray. And Paul says, I'm remembering you. You know, the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. When you remember those that you're praying for, when you remember what God has done, do you know what happens? You're calling that miracle, that promise into being again. We are prophesying again the works of Jesus. And then he says, I keep asking. Wow, this isn't just a one-off prayer. This is, I'm going to keep asking. I keep asking. And he's in accordance here with the will of God. He's not just asking any old thing. And let me tell you, it's not just any old desires. When the psalm says, I'll give you, if you seek me, I'll give you the desires of your heart. They're godly desires, friends. We know that, don't we? But let's remember the eternal pleasures. Let's remember the lasting, the spiritual, the heavenly promises. It's not just, I'm desperate for a new car. Listen, God is interested if you need a new car. Who of us haven't prayed when we've been in financial lack? Who of us haven't prayed for that sort of earthly wisdom? But also, we always want to pray in accordance with the will of God, in accordance with Scripture. I keep asking, okay, so who are you praying to, Paul? Because if you've got some good, great prayers, I want to follow in your example. He says, I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, okay, he's writing to these believers that have come out of a pagan background, they would have been praying to any old god, if you know what I mean. So just up the road in Athens, if you remember in Acts chapter 17, I think it is, when Paul went there, he said, you are so confused, you don't even know the name of the god you are praying to. You're praying to this unknown god. And he said, I've come to tell you that I know the name of the unknown God you're praying to. He's the God of our Lord Jesus Christ. He says this in Ephesus. We're not praying to the ceiling. We're not praying to the cloud. We're not praying nowhere. We're praying to the God, the only true God, the divine being, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. I love this. Let's remember this in our prayers. We're praying to the Lord. He's our master. He's the one we're surrendered to. Our prayers are focused on alignment with him. He's our owner. He's our Lord. He's the one that we say yes to. So we agree with the way to pray. We agree with his revealed word, with the Spirit leading us. So he's the Lord. He's Jesus. He's our Savior. This is who Paul's praying to. He's our Savior. He's our Deliverer, the one who's the total sozo. He's our Shepherd, our Friend. And Christ, the Lord Jesus Christ, he's the anointed Messiah, the promised coming King. It's the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, the glorious Father. I love this. He was from the beginning. He birthed us. He put his DNA in us, his DNA of glory. We belong to him. We're filled with his nature. He's able to impart to you, to infuse to you his very own spirit, because we are his offspring. Wow, this is amazing. He's praying to the glorious Father. What a glorious Father we have. He's glorious because he's filled with splendor. He's filled with magnificence. He's got kingly honor. He is who we're praying to. We're not just praying to an empty room. We're not praying for others to hear us. We're not praying in our own bedroom or lounge and it's not going any further. He is present when we pray. He is listening when we pray. He is actively responsive when we pray. And he is waiting to bring about his will in our lives. And this God, it says, this is his prayer, that he may give you the spirit of wisdom. This glorious Father is breathing his spirit out upon you. That word spirit is like pneuma, so like pneumatic, to do with tires. And I had this picture, it's like the tires being refilled up to the correct mark. And God wants us to be filled, refilled, restored with the breath of his spirit, the pneuma, his spirit, until we are filled with his spirit. And his spirit is a spirit of wisdom and revelation. Oh, I love this. Listen, God is giving us, he's restoring to us a spirit of wisdom. He is clarifying and awarding you with intelligence, with clarity of experience, with ability to learn, and able to interpret, to discern even dreams and times and seasons. The spirit of wisdom is being poured out upon the Ephesian church as Paul prays. And as I pray, the spirit of wisdom is being poured out. The spirit of revelation, that which has been hidden, that mystery which has not yet been disclosed, the curtain is opening on things that we did not know, on things that we did not see, on any dark areas, light is shining. Truth is coming forward out of confusion, out of lies. What's been unseen is going to be seen. And I just release a fresh outpouring in my prayer for you right now, for the spirit of wisdom and revelation to be fulfilled in your life, to be poured out in your life, to be overflowing in your life. And where there's been a draining away of that spirit of wisdom and revelation, that there will be a refilling, that there will be a restoration. And it's for this reason. It's not to make us look like we know it. That, do you remember Paul says, knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. This is to build up the body of Christ. This is the reason here that Paul says in Ephesians is, all of these things, all of these prayers, is to know him better. That's the reason. That's the focus. That's the reason, to know him better. Lumi wrote a song a while back. I just want to, let me paraphrase it. It's just to know you better. It's just to know you better and to learn to live like you, to learn to love like you. Lord, we want to know you better. That's why we need the spirit of wisdom and revelation, in order that we might know you better. You know, prayer, from what I've just said, prayer, you'll realize it's all about relationship. Yes, Jesus said, I pray for the ones that you give me. But the prayer is about our relationship with God, God the Father. It's about our relationship with the Lord Jesus. It's about our relationship with the Holy Spirit. It's not a set alone thing. It is a discipline. It is a spiritual exercise, but it's not something we tick off that we have to do every day. And if we forgot, we have to do it longer the next day. This is our life source. This is talking to God, but listening to him as well. This is knowing how to pray the scripture. This is knowing how to flow with the theme of what he's saying right now, with the times and the seasons. And then he says, I want the eyes of your heart. to be enlightened. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened. Friends, what's the eyes of our heart? We know, you know, we know these scriptures off by heart, back to front, upside down, inside out. We know these verses so well. But as I've just been soaking in them in preparation for this and in my own personal readings and study, I've just said, Lord, what are the eyes of my heart? And they're our thoughts. Let me help you. Our thoughts, our inner thoughts, even our spiritual thoughts, our feelings, emotions, our desires, they're the center of you. They're who you really are. The eyes of my heart, I want to see through my heart, the center of me, the real me inside. And darkness, when we have the eyes of our heart enlightened, darkness is no longer dark. But it's light. The light is turned on. Shadows are no longer shadows, but they're shining and they're bright, and our hearts are enlightened. So here we are. We're restored, as Paul prays for us. And we're restored with the spirit of wisdom and revelation. But then he goes on to say there are three areas, or at least I'm picking up three areas, there's a load more, but there's three areas that I want to encourage us this morning. I want to inspire you for restoration in these areas of your life. Number one, to know the hope to which you have been called. I want you to know restored hope, friends, this morning. There's been a lot of hopelessness around. We can all dip in there from time to time. But I want you to know hopelessness is not your portion. Amen. Hopelessness is not your future. It's not your path. Because here, Paul says, and we agree, he's praying that you might know the hope to which he has called you. I was just so blessed as I gave some attention to this word hope. It's an expectation. It's a desire. It's a belief. It's a trust. I used to think that hope was like the little sister to faith. I'm thinking, well, hope's all right, but it's not as good as faith. And then I found these verses in Colossians. It says, faith and love spring from hope. He's the God of all hope, and he wants to restore hope in you. And out of hope springs faith and love. Do you remember also 1 Corinthians? Paul said, there are three things that remain, faith, hope, and love. The greatest is love. But he tells us in Colossians, but faith and love spring out of hope. We need a restoration of hope. Christ in us is the hope of glory. Are you aware of the Christ in you? Paul wants you to know, and I want you to know, Christ is in you. The risen, ascended King of glory, the Messiah, the anointed one is in you. The anointing is in you because the anointed one is in you. Christ in you. The hope of glory. Hebrews 11, faith is the substance of things hoped for. Hope is not wishy-washy. I'm not talking about, I hope the meat turns out all right at lunchtime. I'm talking about hope in God. My hope, do you remember that song, that old gospel song we all used to sing, my hope is in you, Lord, my hope is in you, it's in you, it's in you. I want us to remind ourselves, our hope is in God. We don't hope just for the weather, we don't hope just for something to turn out well, we don't hope for this to happen, but our hope is founded in God. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus Christ and his righteousness. Our hope does not disappoint us because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts. This is so connected. faith, hope, and love. There is, Job 14 has that wonderful verse, there is hope for a tree when it has been cut down, because even though it's been cut off at the stump, yet at the scent of water, it will spring, it will spurt back to life again. I don't know if you saw the news over the last few weeks, the last few days, last few hours actually, but the sycamore tree that was vandalized on Hadrian's Wall, it was cut down and everyone was really upset because it was a beautiful tree. Everyone took photos of it. It was just magnificent. And then it was cut down. But there's a project which collects, in fact, restores originals, and it had as soon as this had happened, I didn't know, but it collected seeds and branches and twigs and any offcuts of the tree, and they took it and planted it. And I can't remember when this happened, but just yesterday it was in the news that they have planted little seeds from this tree, and they're now this big. And there's hope for the tree that was cut down, that at the scent of water and the TRC that this project has given it, there will be new sycamore trees. Yes, it could take, we were joking about this, it could take hundreds of years to reach that size again. But there's hope. There is a future. Friends, have things been cut down in your life? Have things been cut back? And instead of being a person of hope, there's been an air of hopelessness. I want you to know that at the scent of water, the water of God's flowing river of his spirit, the water of his word, that hope can be restored. Proverbs 13, you know these, I'm just sharing some really well-known verses with you. Hope deferred makes the heart sick. Do you know that what happens to our thought life, our spiritual life, our emotional life has such a connected effect on our physical being? And if there is any sickness, let's always go back to the Lord and say, is there any hopelessness there? Is there any trauma? Is there any area of my life that I need to get healed on the inside so that you can heal this physical body on the outside? Proverbs tells us, hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a desire fulfilled, sorry, hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a desire fulfilled is a tree of life. It might take a longer time to grow again, but it's growing. Friends, I just speak restoration of hope. Restoration of hope. Romans 5, we boast in the hope of the glory of God. And you know, character produces hope. Oh, we don't like that verse from 1 Peter. We don't like it when we suffer a little while. We'd rather just be on a bed of lie on a bed of roses. But character produces hope. You want hope to increase in your life? Then God, you touch my character. Make me more like Christ through filling me with your spirit, through obedience to your spirit, and through a life that follows you so that I can know a hope-filled life. That was restored hope. What else is Paul praying for you? And I'm praying for you as well. That you may know the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints. The riches of his inheritance. Do you know your inheritance in Christ? Do you know what you've inherited? Do you know what you've got already? Do you know what you're looking forward to? We often pray for people that have had inheritances stolen. And we've got many testimonies, people that have had a house given back to them, they've had a mortgage paid off, you know, a solicitor has said, this paperwork has now gone through and you are the rightful heir. We've had amazing testimonies. We have a friend in South Africa who called us, and we used to stay with them every year when we went to minister down there in the Cape. And she called us a few years ago and she said, you would not believe this, but I had a great uncle who I hardly knew, and I was the only remaining heir. I've just been given a lot of money. I'm coming over to visit. And she was able to do some, to fulfill some of her dreams. She didn't know the inheritance that was waiting for her. Friends, Paul prays that we might know the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints. I just think this is amazing. This is abundance, friends. This is fullness. This is God not holding back of himself. As Heavenly Father, all that's his is yours. We are heirs of the Father and co-heirs with Christ. That means we have a promise now and a future inheritance. But the promise isn't just distant, because the Holy Spirit himself guarantees our inheritance. It's as good as a legal document. The Holy Spirit filling me, filling you, is a guarantee. It cannot be revoked. There is an inheritance for you. The Holy Spirit filling you is proof that there's a coming inheritance, more than we have already. Every spiritual blessing in Christ is ours already. Let me remind you what they are, just from the beginning of Ephesians 1. He chose you. Friends, that's your inheritance. You are chosen. It cannot be taken away from you. You are predestined. There is a plan and purpose for you. You are adopted to sonship, whether you feel like it, whether you don't, whether you think you've got to earn it, let me tell you, you don't. He is your Father. You are the heirs. Their adoption has taken place because of what Jesus has done on the cross, and there is an eternal inheritance for every one of us. Adoption to sonship. We have redemption through his blood. We have forgiveness of sins, and we know God's grace. He's lavished upon us. Listen, we have a guarantee of that inheritance already through the precious Holy Spirit. You know, Peter says that this inheritance is incorruptible. Sometimes we watch some antique programs or some house restoration programs on TV, which I think are so much fun. And some houses, oh my word, they were like mansions once, and they have totally gone to rack and ruin. And I'm thinking, how can they possibly be restored? And then you might see something of the restoration story. I've got news for you. Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you, so that where I am, there you may be also. This mansion never needs restoring. It's being prepared by the Lord Jesus Christ himself, and there is a place for you in his kingdom, and in his heavenly eternal kingdom. And he said the reason he's done that is because he wants us to be with him, to be where he is. Now we can, I know that where two and three meet together, there he is. I'm just so glad that when we sang and invited him this morning in our worship, there came a moment when we just realized he is here. He is worthy. He is seated. We've invited him. He is here when we pray, when we're present. He is here too. But there is an eternal home for us as well. We have a goodly inheritance. There is an inheritance laid up in heaven for us. an eternal possession that God has freely given. An inheritance is something that comes from one generation to the next. You may be here this morning and think, well, there's no practical, there's no earthly inheritance coming to me. We're going to be praying for you later in a few moments about those sort of things. But I want you to know that there is an inheritance kept in heaven for you. It's incorruptible. Moth nor rust, it says, can break in. Thieves can't break in and steal. There are treasures for you to access, heart treasures for you to access as we look forward to the fullness of our inheritance, as well as experiencing that inheritance right now, guaranteed. I don't know, it's like having a taster before you have the actual meal. If you go out tasting something or you go to the market stores and they say, have a bit of my cheese, and you have a taste. Listen, that's nothing in comparison. But once you get the taste, you think, I must get more. Friends, dig into, step into, obtain, possess more of that inheritance that's yours. You are a son. You are a daughter of your Father. He's not a God who holds back from you. We're talking about prayer. We're talking about inheritance. He wants to give you what you ask for in accordance with his will. Wow. And the third thing that he's restoring, I think there was probably a few more, but this is my third thing, that he's praying that we might see restored in our lives. He says, and I'm praying that you might know his incomparable, his immeasurable great power for us who believe. That same power that God exerted when he raised Christ Jesus from the dead. Friends, that power is ours. That power is ours. It's not somebody else's. It's not next week's speakers only. It's not somebody that's on the TV or somebody that we read. It's ours. Ours. We have access to power. I want us to see power restored in our lives, that we might know that great, mighty power. His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life, Peter says. Oh, I'm just so grateful. This is not a lesser power. This is not a reused power, a recharged power. This is the same power that raised Christ from the dead. His incomparably great power for us who believed. It's the same as his mighty strength. Who needs might in their lives? Who needs to be re-strengthened? Who needs to know that instead of being powerless, we can be powerful in the might that God gives to us? It's the same as the mighty strength which raised Christ from the dead and has seated him. So it's not only raised him, it's seated him at the right hand of God in the heavenly realms. That's where we are, friends. That's where we are. His power has raised us. It's raised me. It's seated me in the heavenly realms, in heavenly places. Friends, get hold of this. This is not just a lovely picture or a lovely message or something lovely to read. This is true. I'm telling you the truth. His power has raised you. His power has lifted you into the heavenly realms. It's resurrection power. This is what I want to see you restored with, filled with, overflowing with. Resurrection power, life-giving power, incomparably great power, immeasurable. Just don't tell me he can't do it. It's immeasurable power. It's miraculous power. It's wonder-working power. Do you need this? Do you need this in your life? Is there any situation that you need miraculous power for? What about your family? What about that one in your family that needs a touch, that needs renewed health, that needs a powerful miracle? What about that brokenness that however you encourage someone, you can't see them get through it? We need God's power. You know, we often think of God's power, which the word is dunamis, and immediately we think of dynamite. Now, when I think of dynamite, I think of I think of like a bridge being blown up, and I'm thinking, no, it's one off, and it's powerful, and it's over, and there's a lot of smoke and dust. But this is not that sort of dunamis power. This is strength and might. This is magnificence. This is something which carries on. It's not a one-off. It carries on. This is power that is from above. This is heavenly power. This is not just a one-off action. It's not man-made power. That's what I'm trying to say. This is a power above all powers. You know, we sing all glory, all honor, all power. This is all power. He's all powerful. And Paul is praying that we might know that power, his incomparably great power for us who believe. His divine power has been given to us. It has been given to us. It's available to us. It's stronger than anything we could imagine. It will answer every weakness. It will answer every infirmity. It will raise everything that has fallen. It will do it in our personal lives. But friends, also, not only do I want us to know that resurrection power in our lives, I want us to know that resurrection power with all those we meet, that it might flow through us, that we might be carriers of his power, just like we might be carriers of his hope, carriers of the inheritance that we can pour out as sons and daughters, that we might be carriers of his power. That's my prayer for you this morning. I love the church, just like Paul loved the church at Ephesus. I love the church. I love that the church has been growing. I love that the church has seen new life, that there's been many who have just been coming to Christ over even this year, that there's baptisms on Resurrection Sunday, that there's people who are engaged in a walk of discipleship. That I just love the vibrant life that's in the church. But friends, if there's any area at all that I have touched on this morning that we need to see God restore, my prayer for you is that hope will be restored, is that inheritance will be realized and restored, and that the power of God, the same power which raised Christ Jesus from the dead, will be applied in our lives, will be activated, will be realized in our lives.